we have said that if you have what we say is a Gaussian random field, this field with random faces, then all the information is enclosed in the power spectrum or the correlation function, because this is covering the information. This statement has several consequences in the context of what we have been discussing today. So one of the consequences is the following. Imagine that you have a field which is got the same distribution for the amplitude as the one of the Gaussian field has, but not the same distribution for the phases. You made a mistake when you were generating your Gaussian random field, your advisor asked you, and then you can generate properly your random number, and now the phases are not random. Did you generate a Gaussian random field? No. Therefore, not all the information is enclosed in the power spectrum or correlation function. So if somebody had to reproduce the property of that field, they would have to know what type of mistake you made, that's why the field is going. This will also mean that there's some extra information there that is not captured by the power spectrum or the measure function. This means that when you do the expansion in the moment, it's not true anymore that you can stop. It means that the cumulative hyperarrest and the capital zero now. You don't know which one. But at least one of them will be zero. So you have a question.
The difference between that equation and the exponential and the exponential mass equation
is the truth, yes. Exactly.
What happens to the
truth? Well, if it is up here, this is the definition, right? But now if you want to know what is n, the effective n at a given k, which is different from k naught, since n is d log k, d log k, then what is that? Okay. Now, the other thing I want to so I try to argue that this it's a piece from a Gaussian random field. Now, before the phase is a piece around. Now, the phases of this are random if I had basically an infinite volume, and then I could really sample the phases all over the book. And then I would see that that's a uniform distribution. However, if I have a small piece of this type, then I have only a finite number of nodes, and therefore the phases have been sampled by this finite number of nodes. And therefore, this is a sample drawn from a random distribution. But it's not perfectly random, it's not uniform because I have only few. And so, if I was looking at a different piece of that same realization, the phase distribution would not be the same. In other words, and it would look different because this cluster would not be here, it would be somewhere else, and this pillar would have a different orientation, who knows. But what matters to us is that at the cosmological level, there's no interesting information. So there is interesting information if you want to repeat the same realization. Then people that do n-body simulation, sometimes they know that they want to do different simulations with the same initial condition, exactly because they want to keep the initial phases the same, which may be useful, for example, for the mixing constant and things like that. But there's no fundamental information. Everybody follows. So even despite this, we still keep treating the sea of this time as a Gaussian random field and assume that it's Gaussian random physics and compress the information into the CL and keep on going from that. Again, since there are a few modes in here, it may simply be that you haven't fully sampled the distribution of the phases of the body in ALM and the M. And this maybe is not so special. Now, I'm not going to enter in this discussion because this discussion has been going on for 10 years and there are people from both sides and that would make sense. Not anymore. Okay. So let's go back to this. The initial condition, even if the initial condition were Gaussian, although some may argue, no, but actually inflation can have some small deviation from Gaussianity, and that may be interesting. I'm not going to deny that, but I can say that the first order approximation is Gaussian. But then, of course, gravitational evolution makes it not. And then, what we sample is the distribution of galaxies, which is not a continuous field, although this was not a continuous field to start with, since it's an ungod simulation. The definition is discrete, but it has been. Density has been computed on a grid, so it could be represented as if it was a continuum. And then there are also other type of real world effects. Like, for example, you don't observe a cube. You see many more galaxies nearby than far away. So let's touch upon a little bit this and see what consequences this are if we have a statistics of So first, I want to go back to moments versus cumulants. And so, even if at the beginning you started off with a Gaussian, where this was zero and this was no zero, but everything else would be k bigger than 3 and bigger than zero, this is obviously not. So it means that as gravity go on and as galaxies start forming, and you only see galaxies, you don't see the dark matter, all these things start popping up. And maybe an infinite series. Although it may be useful in case you need to compute some of this higher term to have this in mind, which is a method of reducing higher order derivative to a combinatorics problem. And it's used in quantum theory. Some of you have seen this type of advance like that. It's called function here. For example, if you have this 6.1, then you can expand it in terms of 2, 2, 2, 2, 4, 3, 3, and then 6. So this is equivalent to this 6 term, 2 and 4, a times with 3, and a times with 2. And but instead of taking many derivatives, you are doing the combinatorics. And indeed, it's a as you see. Okay. Okay, well let's say that. Let's go to discuss some of the real world issues since we never said an infinite box. And we never do an exact transform and see how these things are then used. One of the first things that come up, for example, is well, I can do a discrete Fourier transform or a fast Fourier transform, and then a real Fourier transform. So I define my field in a grid, and then at each grid point I define some density, and then I deal that. Even if you assume what are called periodic boundary conditions, so you take your box and then you just assume it goes on and on and on, your distribution of the k is still discrete. But and also you have pixelized your density field. So all these effects end up showing up on the statistic that then you use. And so to pixelize, you can use things like cloud, you have a green point, you have a shade cloud, etc. Remember that you have to decompose the principal factors. If you don't do it, then you may have problems on small scales. If you have it on a larger scale, it doesn't matter. Then there are other discretization effects that you have shorter swivians that you can sample given the fact that they discretize your field. And you can't throw it away. If you computed your field density here and here, you can't throw them all with a frequency that is higher than this. So you may want to keep this in mind as well. Finally, usually they assume periodic boundary conditions. So they assume that if you have a board in your box, when you replicate your box, here it just continues to spread. And you have a support transition. In reality, if you don't have periodic boundary condition, then when you take this box and then to this mode, and then put another one nearby, and then assume you have a much bigger volume, then here you have a sharp transition. And as you know, when you Fourier transform something that is sharp, then you get a feature. And you get a transfer of power between different nodes. So this is basically this. It will be a very high, this transition will be described by a very high frequency oscillation in space, which is actually maybe not there. We don't know, but it's curious. So you may want to keep this in mind. Other type. Whenever you have a real galaxy survey, you don't have the same probability of observing objects that they are nearby or that they are far away. And sometimes you may want to cut, for example, the galaxy, cut bright stars, cut things in the part of the sky that you can't see. And so you end up having what is called a window or a mask. Let's think it in the simplest terms. In the simplest terms, instead of having a perfect cube, observing the things in a perfect cube, you are probably seeing a cone. And this cone are going to have orbits, and it's going to have strange edges, and then you want to avoid what you don't want to see, etc. So, in real space, the true density field goes and transforms into the observed one, which is the true one multiplied by some weight. And this is a multiplication in real space. So at each point in space, you have a weight that says, well, here maybe you have a observed only 80% of the time, and not 100% that you should observe. Here, you have not observed because it was the galaxy, so you know. Here, I don't know, there was the sun, and so you don't want to point the telescope to the sun, or whatever. And so this is a multiplication in real space. When you go to Fourier space, a multiplication becomes a convolution. So, what do I mean by this star? By these stars, I mean that delta of k is delta of k prime times wk minus k prime integrated in k prime. This is what this star means. In other words, delta of k depends on all other k prime that are left in front of k. And how much it depends on it depends on the shape of this quantity. If this quantity was a Dirac delta function, who cares? But this quantity, if I take the effort of writing it down, it's probably not a Dirac delta function. And therefore, that complicates things. So we're going to go back to this issue later. There are a couple of ways to But what you may want to keep in mind is that we say that for ourselves here, the density, the delta of k1 and delta of k2 are not correlated. The moment you put a window in, the observed delta of k with the observed delta of k prime is not true anymore, that they are not correlated. It depends on the form of this formula. So, the covariance matrix is not the element anymore. The presence of the vector. The other things you want to have in mind is what happened due to discrete and shotguns. So far, everything applies to a continuous distribution, but the distribution of galaxies, for example, is not continuous. And in principle, it could be non Gaussian, and in fact, if it's Poisson, it is non Gaussian, because Poisson is not Gaussian. Let's assume that you want to compute its effect on the power spectrum and not on what the effect is on the global distribution. Then you say, well, what I want to observe is on number density at position x. So my number density position x is the average one, 1 plus the density field, and then I can describe that as a sum of the delta function. This is the average of the test. So like we did for a Poisson distribution, you can say, well, let me now make a grid where I can have only 1 or 0 of these galaxies in there. And remember that for the Poisson distribution, average and variance are always. And now we have all the information we need to see what happened to the discrepancies, for example, to the correlation function, because this. So what is the correlation function? Then it's the sum of the position I and j of two delta here, and this is 1 and 2, these are 1 and 2 is the separation, and of course the correlation function should only depend on the absolute, the modulus of the difference between L1 and L2, if everything is symmetric. And so this is n bar 1 plus correlation function plus, sorry, correction. And so we get that L1 and L2 is this, where this is the discrete one. So here is the correction. This is your shock noise conversion. So it's clear why, right? Because you have this excess correction coming from there. And therefore, in Fourier space, the correlation function goes into the power spectrum and one of the number. Now, for those that do BAO, right, Baryon acoustic oscillations, the survey that do Baryon acoustic oscillations tends to be tuned so that, I don't need to discuss this with that project, so that n times p is bigger than 1 at k of 0.2. Can you guess why? This. So P is your signal. That's where the Baryon oscillations are. The Baryon oscillations are marked in the short ones. 1 over n is your noise, this additive contribution to the power spectrum. That is going to be short ones. So NP is a signal to noise ratio. The second BAO being fed by k of 0.2, so you want to have a signal to noise greater than 1 by the time the signal of the BAO is coming out. Okay. So now I want to think a little bit and maybe discuss of what are the pros and the cons of using the power spectrum versus the correlation function. And I have some questions for you to stimulate discussion. So the first question is, in an ideal case, where we have an infinite volume, in a cosmological context, which one of the two has the simplest covariance? Now the field will be non-Gaussian because it's a ball. So it's the field that's got, it's not Kuligowski because of gravitational evolution. Then the power spectrum covariance is not the Young anymore. Chances are that probably it's not too far away from being something that is diagonal dominant. At least that you have a way to describe this is more of a diagonal terms based on our gravity form.
If I have a cross-spectrum which is slightly Kuligowski anymore, I can still make an operation which separates the matrices into diagonal and not diagonal. What is the physical meaning of the non-diagonal matrix then?
So the question is, if I have a field that is not Gaussian and I compute these powers, then you say the covariance of that power spectrum is not the diagonal. So what's the next step?
I can make still a very good operation which splits this covariance into a diagonal and non-diagonal.
I can always do that, but why would you, so is there a reason to do that?
I don't know, is it like linearization level? Is there a physical property in this non-diagonal, which I can get up to physically? Or is it just like a medical operation?
Well, it's a medical operation, it would be a thing before. It does what to do, if it is going to do something with reality. So there are operations that you can actually try to do to your field to run it back in time and linearize it. But what these operations do, they can't do that with power spectrum, knowing only the power spectrum. So again, people who did the variable acoustic oscillations will know that if you want to have a high signal to noise for your variable acoustic oscillation, if you want to sharpen what is going to be, you want to apply reconstruction. What is reconstruction? Is to say, it's true that I have a Gaussian field because it was evolved from a Gaussian field. But if I, instead of just keeping the power spectrum, which is now is lossless, lossy compression, I go back to the actual map. What the phases are in there, and then I say, if I know the density, I know the velocity. So if I know the velocity, I can move the particle back in time because I know the velocity. So I can undo a little bit what gravity has done, and I can linearize the field, and I can Gaussianize it, of course, at the same time. And then, surprise, surprise, this sharpens the variable acoustic oscillation. Why does it sharpen the variable acoustic oscillation? Well, because non-linearity induce no Gaussianity through mode coupling. And mode coupling, we've seen, you can write it as a convolution. Convolution means that if you the information that you measure in K depends on what the order K is. So if before this gravitational evolution you had a sharp peak, this mode coupling will make the peak less sharp. And that reduces your VAO signal to noise. But now you say, now I'm smart, right? I just go back to the actual distribution, the actual 2D or 3D distribution, and where the phase information is there. And now I use that to undo this. I undo this mode coupling and sharpen the VAO peak. Now, you can't do that perfectly in a very high linear machine, but you can do that with a little bit of relative experience. So that's the magic of reconstruction. And so reconstruction should also make your variance a little bit more reliable because you can analyze it in a new Gaussian example. Okay. What is the effect of the presence of a survey piece? So in the correlation function, like in the real space, you start with multiplication. But in Fourier space, it's again not a correlation. So what would be the effect of a survey mask on, say, a power spectrum? again, mode couple. It's the your covariance matrix with the power spectrum is not diagonal anymore. Now, if you know extremely well what your mask is, you know that extremely well. But it's still there, and so you have to account for it. And depending on the geometry of the mask, it can be more or less masked. So at some point, there were some surveys, like the 2-degree galaxy galaxy survey, that since you had a finite amount of the telescope and you wanted to map to sample the very large scales, they were doing like pencil beams and then separating them randomly to cover the large scales. Something similar is happening on the people that do the Lyman alpha. They try to reconstruct the 3D power spectrum of the Lyman alpha forest. You get the quasars, and the quasars are observed, and so on the line of sight, you have a really good sampling of the distribution, but across the sky, well, you sample where you send quasars. It's a very similar problem. And of course, you can imagine what the effect of that survey mass may be. You have a very lot of modes everywhere, and modes coming everywhere. It doesn't mean that you can't describe it, it means that it's not. I also want to say something about locality, because it may be useful both for what things both in the cosmic microwave diagram and in large scale structure. The Fourier transform is a very cool thing, right? You get to see this mode, etc. But it's hard, it makes things non-localized. So if you measure a mode of a given wavelength, you don't know where it was. You don't know if that came from this side of the box or that side of the box, because obviously you are assuming that it doesn't matter if it was from this side or that side of the box. You decided to throw away that phase information. Well, it gets all mixed up. It's a mixed up. Advanced. Which one is easier to compute? If I give you a simulation box and I say compute the correlation compute the correlation function and compute the power spectrum, which one will you try to compute first? Power spectrum one. Right. You have 15 and then it just takes squares and average. While if you went to the correlation function, unless you have some smart algorithm, you have to start. I sit on a galaxy, I define a distance, and I count all the galaxies around the distance, then I sit on another galaxy, count, then I sit on another galaxy, count, and it's very numerical heavy. This we sort of discussed in a little bit already, what is the effect of non-linearities. So that's just. Okay, so far we talked about galaxy densities, galaxy surveys, and so what happened to the cosmic microwave? We can make very similar arguments, except that the temperature over density of density fluctuation, temperature fluctuation, is expanded in spherical harmonics, instead of Fourier. And then one defines the spherical harmonic coefficients ALM, which are again related to the temperature fluctuation gain via spherical harmonics. And then one defines the angular power spectrum, the famous CLs, by this operation of the ALMs. So when you run CAM and CAM out the phi, which is got L's and C's, that vector comes inside. And so the C's are related to the ALM, this. But then remember that also when you plot it, you may want, you don't usually plot the CL directly. So here it is. Here is the CMD map, and then you decide that this is Gaussian, and so you can compress all that information that you get. You don't care about the phases, you compress all that information in a power spectrum, in an angular power spectrum, and then in order for you not to have to plot something that goes out of the plot, you plot L times L plus 1 CL. And this is what comes from some pizza. And you can guess what those things are. Okay, so far so good. But this is a highly doctored map. If you actually take the map of the project, even in the frequency range, it's the cleanest, you don't get that. What you get, you get what you get. Be very careful where you look to the galaxy and other places that you want to cut out, because what you see are the foreground stuff, not the original stuff, the original stuff. So again, we have the same issue that we had in the existing structures. So, for example, sky cut. What you end up measuring if you cut the sky is again a sort of convolution. It's a multiplication of the space on the temperature times the width. Here, you don't want to set. Here, you don't want to set. And also, you may have an effect of pixelization. In principle, right, the temperature is a continuous thing. You can't sample it continuously. You have to pixelize the sky, and then each pixel decides what the average temperature of the pixel is, also because of the finite resolution of the experiment. And so the spherical harmonic coefficient you end up measuring is also corrected by the average. And this can get nasty for you. But let me try to give you a taste for how this works. So, if what you measure is actually this, you can say, oh, okay, let me make some CL out of those, even though it's not exactly the CL that is in the sky. And so I define something, it's called CL, which is just CL for those in the M. Clearly, this CL is not the real 2 CL that is in the sky. And I should not compare that directly with the output of count to the logical one of the estimates. Why? Well, because this can be written as a convolution over some sort of mode coupling function of the output, which is the output. And this quantity is written in terms of this, you know, the product of three spherical harmonics, and this quantity depends on the geometry. This is the harmonic transform of how you cut the sky. So it's very similar to what we saw when we were going through the transform of three dimensions. We have a sort of convolution which involves. So when you measure CL2 equal L, you don't measure, say, L equal 10, you don't measure L equal 10. You measure L equal 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 7. It's a different weight due to the form of this window. And this window is usually sharp, so this thing is usually understood. So this looks a lot like this. So you have two approaches. Large scale structure people just stop here and say, okay, bad luck. What you measure is this, what can give you is this. You want to characterize this very well, and then every time you sample a different modeling parameter space before you compare them with data, you you run your theory through this convolution and that will find a way. And then all the complications is going to be hidden in the way you compute the covariance matrix. And that's a problem for the guys that do the survey, and then they give you the covariance matrix and they run it. So that's one approach. What's fine? Except when you have features that are then smoothed out by this. Because at that point you've lost information and you're not going to recover the information. What the cosmic microwave background people are trying to do instead, they are trying to invert this. Then they identify the average CL with CL. And they say, then I'm done here. So if this G function imagine it's known extremely well and it's very simple, and when L prime is a little bit far away from L goes to zero, you can imagine it. If you find G and you can invert it, and the inversion is stable, and this is localized, then this is. Unfortunately, inverting this G may not be always possible. And then in that case, you can't do this. Okay, so we got the window. And then the instrument of photo creates a noise associated. So we had shock noise in that structure. Here instead we have instrumental noise. However, to have an extremely good approximation, the instrumental noise is not correlated with the signal that is there in the sky. And so you have a superposition of two independent processes, the one that is out there in the sky is about the inflation, and the one that is in the instrument. And so you end up, again, just the ALM that you see is the signal plus. And therefore, for the measure CL, CL is given by the signal that runs in the sky, CL of noise. So what is the CL of noise? Well, it's just the ALM of your noise squared by the sound. So, if you use this, and you compare that with what comes out from the camera, what comes out from CAM will be this. So this will be a bias estimator of the real CI. You do get the parameters. However, there's a trick. The trick you can do is to say, but look at that, right? Can I make this to be zero? Say I have two detectors, and say the two detectors don't know anything about each other. One detector will have a noise, and we have an A noise with zero average. The other detector will have an A noise with zero average. However, when you try to do the CL for, that is the cross correlation between the two detectors, what will you get? You get zero. If the two detectors don't know anything about each other, they are correlated. By being uncorrelated means that the correlation is zero. And so one useful trick you can do, and it's actually is being done, is to use the cross power spectrum. So whenever you have more than one detector and you want to compute your final CLs, you don't say, I take the detector with itself, the detector with itself, the detector with itself. No, you always take the detector with another detector, the detector with another detector, and then this terms drops out. However, there's no free lunch. And there's no free lunch for two reasons. The first reason is not written here, but it should be obvious. You're throwing away information. You're throwing away the information that you could have by correlating the detector with inside of the Fibonacci's case, or if you know by Fibonacci multiplication. For a large number of detectors, this effect gets smaller and smaller and smaller, right? For only one detector, you can't even do it. As the number of detectors grows, what you lose by throwing away the output ratio becomes smaller. And the other reason why there's no free lunch is because do you think that the noise disappears when you actually try to compute the errors of your CLs? No, it's still there. It's still there in the other parts. We are still doing worse than having a noiseless experiment. But at least you're not getting a bias estimate of CLs. Okay. Then, there's one last thing. Beams. No experiment has perfect resolution. And so you always see the sky fall to a beam. And now, the beam is a convolution in actual real spaces. And the beam is not similar to the filter that we discussed in our discussion today. You define a filter, you want to look at the scales bigger than the filter, and apply, say, a low mass. So this is a convolution in real space, but as we know, they are called high bandpass filter and low bandpass filter, exactly because when you go to Fourier space, in any case, to harmonic space, then it becomes a multiplication. So for Gaussian beams, we measure CLs, and if you only have beams, no noise and no sky, it will be the C that is in the sky times E, type something that looks like a Gaussian. And for Gaussian beams, you can say how this number is related to the full width half max of the beam of your beam. Now adding noise. So what you see is the one in the sky convolved by your beam plus the noise. And you say, aha, but what count gives me is what's out there in the sky, not what's out there in the sky convolved by the beam. So let me deconvolve by the beam. Deconvolve by the beam is very easy in harmonic space. You just multiply by 1 over this. So I multiply by 1 over this, and I get this. Look what happened to the noise. Blows up because you have e to the l square times sigma multiplied by the noise. So what happens if your beams is or are not well known? And I'm gonna try giving the last tips. So, try. get some Cl out, plug. Then assume that you have some noise from the Cl's, and assume that the noise is just in Cl, not Ln plus 1 Cl, it's constant. Just a number. And sum them up. Then, deconvolve with the beam, then convolve your Cl to the beam, and then try to deconvolve that. So if you deconvolve that, you can deconvolve the noise as well. Sum them up and plug them again. And then subtract out the noise Cl by computing it a slightly long beam. And see what happens. want me to show the solution? Do you want me to show the effect of the solution only? So you can still try to work it out yourself. Eventually, the effect of the solution, and then we have to wait. So, yeah, please. So because of the effect of the beam, the noise goes up. Because of the effect of the beam, the noise goes up, and also because of the effect of the beam, your CL gets compressed. If you don't know your beams well, the overall shape of your CLs is going to be twisted, and also the overall level of the noise is going to be wrong, and the noise becomes very quickly extremely important as you would find. So, look at these are the WMAP amplifier. Actually, the WMAP because Planck noise is so much lower that by the time you see this effect, you go to very high end where the music start going down and so on. So, of course, the concept is the same. Look how the error remains small and then suddenly they blow up. The beam actually started kicking in somewhere here, right? But then you can take back power, you can try to compensate, but you know, it goes exponential. And so at some point there's nothing else you can do. Your error bar becomes so large. And even though you may have been super careful of knowing extremely where you're being and not having these CLs going like that because of the beam, still the effect is in the. Okay. So